Hello, this is the RPG Chick. Welcome back to Let's Play Pillars of Eternity Blind. We're in the Blackhound Inn. People that we look at. We get histories and the essence of their soul. Voices from their past. I mean, you can pause this if you want. We've already read all these three. And a couple people downstairs.
Got it.
We read a book. I didn't realize they had books. Like in Skyrim and such. The Deerwood Part 1, Early Colonial History. In guest. Please leave me be. I am full to sickness with what I have seen of this place and its people. What are you talking about? I am from Red Saris, true, but if I followed the scattered god yet, would I not have remained there? What of my family? Gods, to think I came all this way. May you meet with better fortune in Gilded Vale than I. I need 3 lockpicks? Is he gonna, like, tell on me?
There! Done!
You have to yell that out like that? Ooh! A minor cloak of protection. Of fortitude? I guess it means of protection of these. Plus 5, reflex plus 5, will plus 5. Capes and cloaks can be worn for protection from the elements and from prying eyes alike. Many are woven with spells to provide additional defense or abilities. Like this one. Scroll, Tanglefoot. Ooh, nice. Hey, get... Uh-oh. We're gonna be in trouble. Requires 2 lore. Rapidly grows a bunch of twisted vines that surround and entangle anyone unlucky enough to get caught inside. Characters who set foot inside the area of effect become hobbled. And the jasper. Jasper is found in the wild as a dull, mottled stone, frequently a red or green, but often with a variety of colors lent by other surrounding minerals. While relatively easy to find, polish, the stone's distinctive swirls of color give it endless variety. Sorry. Doesn't mind that much, I guess. There's another book. Nothing like Baldur's Gate in the beginning when you steal something and you got the whole... Sing us a song, Blissa. You got the whole inn coming after you. For the last time, I don't know any dwarven drinking songs. I'm from Logholm. Ha, you were right. She does get rosy-cheeked when she's angry. Huh. So what about this book? 10 Years of Dawn. 10 years I tilled the Vorless Leaf, and 10 years I told myself that living in St. Widwin's footsteps would bring me rebirth. Each dawn I'd pray that if thou art in darkness, he shall bring thee light, and each night would bring the same emptiness. For my decade of living as a simple dye farmer, all I have to show for it is a great deal of purple clothing. Eothas has not spoken to us since he appeared at St. Widwin. It is my hope that Eothas would claim me as his next vessel, but alas, the Child of Light remains silent. Every day I practiced a ritual of banishing the shadows of the unfaithful, and every day I work my fields in solitude, without sign of Eothas returning. If thou art in darkness, he shall bring thee light, but how long must I remain lost in this long night of abandonment? Is this my punishment for keeping my faith a secret? Is Eothas hiding from me until I shout my reverence for all to hear? Surely he must know that the Deerwoodens now hate him and his followers. My countrymen are quick to blame all that was terrible about the Saints' War on those of us still faithful to Eothas. Should they not be angry at the Riad Saris soldiers? Do the Deerwoodens not realize that to dismiss the God of Rebirth and Redemption is to prevent all hope of healing? As I pen these words, I know that I must continue to till the dye leaf. I will awaken each day with hope. If thou art in darkness, he shall bring me light. Each day I will pray that the dawn stars visit me, just as they visited Saint Waedwin in the... I'm not sure how to pronounce that. Is that... It's not Waedwin, and it's kind of like Widewin, but it's kind of like Waedwin or something. Will they come to me as they came to Saint Waedwin? As a man and two women, luminescent and perfect, I am told that they come to presage new times. I am told many things, and I struggle to find the faith to believe it all. And yet, each morning the sun rises in the eastern sky, and each morning Eothas illuminates my simple plot of land, casting away the shadows of the unfaithful in his golden gaze. I thank thee, Eothas, for all the springs I've had and all that will come. I am in darkness. Please bring me light. Yeah, give her this. Here's a regular cape. I didn't realize he had this. Capes are popular throughout the Eastern Reach, commonly made of wool or animal pelts. Capes provide warmth on cool nights and through deep winters. I'm gonna hold on to that then. Ooh, I didn't look at here last time. Here's his grimoire. These are the spells he knows. Archimere's dazzling lights overwhelms anyone in the area of effect with a brilliant and bewildering pyrotechnic display, increasing their will and leaving them dazed. Area of effect. Faux area of effects, which... I think means we can cast it in the middle of friendlies and we won't get friendly fire. Fan of flames creates a cone of fire in front of the caster, causing burn damage to anyone in the area of effect. This is plain area of effect. Will it hurt anybody in that area? Calicoth's sunless grasp. The caster's hands become so cold as to freeze what they touch, does freeze damage to a target, and reduces its accuracy. Minoletta's minor missiles summons three spell missiles that batter the target, inflicting crush damage. Okay, this is the equivalent of magic missile. And doesn't look like versus deflection. Okay, so it could technically miss. Not in grimoire. So as far as I know, we need to get another grimoire to put this in. Or combat only. Does he just know this? Creates a duplicate of the caster, yeah, like that potion. No spells. I wonder what it takes to get spell slots for these later ones. Yep. Okay. So I kind of hesitate to give him this. I mean, could he put this in his grimoire? It's like a druid spell, isn't it? Normally a druid spell is like a tangling vine kind of thing. But maybe anyone can use this since it's a scroll. Hold on to that, of course. I forgot to reset. I think I'm 12 minutes in? I'm not even sure. Oh, there's a black hound. These bones are covered in tiny bite marks. Is he friendly? Aww. This hound stares intently at the covered window, head cocked as if waiting to hear a particular sound. It looks up when you approach and whines a low note, tail wagging slightly. Pet the dog. The dog's tail thumps happily against the floorboards. That wasn't done. We can't take the dog. Don't tell a dog that. That's not... Yeah. Just, okay, I'm done after all. I've been in there. Is it outside? I thought we were upstairs, though. Oh, okay. No, don't run off like that. Okay, I guess we're done in here. We came from there. Well, we need to get that. All the things. Hello? Tuatanu's one of the best smiths in the Deerwood, but his stock's been lousy lately. Is that so? Poor Aufra. And then I told her, that's not the pistol. Ha! Did you hear the bells? I'll count in. Did you hear what? I don't know what you said. Oh wait, did you hear the bells? Yeah. Think she'll say yes? She's mad enough to lie with you. Why not wed you while she's at it? More bandits. More bandits. And that's where he came from, this village square, such as it is. It's us. Oh, Aufra's house. She's the one who gave birth to... I'm guessing it's a godlike? I heard they fended off another attack on Lord Radric's keep. Well, let's go in. Ciphers use focus to power their abilities and can gain additional stuff. Well, we know our priorities. Let's go pet the cat first. Okay, we can't do anything with the cat. Okay. Hello, Aufra. A dear wooden woman is standing in front of the fireplace, humming a quiet tune to herself, or perhaps to her unborn child, for she is clearly quite pregnant. She turns her head slightly as you enter. Okay, this isn't the one who gave birth, then.
Well met, friend.
Well, finally, I was starting to think. The woman makes a startled noise when she turns around and sees you. Oh, I'm sorry, I was expecting someone else. She gives you a cautious smile. Can I help you? I just arrived in Gilded Vale. I thought I'd get to know the locals. And I do that by just walking in their home and petting their cat. Or trying to. Were you with one of the caravans? She looks at you hopefully. Master Odima's by any chance? You knew Odima? Well, no more than most here, I'd say. He doesn't usually come this way, but they say he's a reliable old fellow. She pauses, brows furrowing. Wait, why do you say new? I'm sorry, but the caravan was attacked. I was the only one to survive. Aufra covers her mouth with a hand, eyes wide with horror. For a few moments, she can manage nothing but a strangled, voiceless gasping, her eyes brimming with tears. Oh, sheesh. At least I didn't say it to her the other way, the rude way. I knew. I told her it was a dangerous path to take. Kalisha was always so certain she could take on any danger. Aufra sniffs. Oh, my poor sister. I'm sorry, stranger. I can't believe she's gone. Kalisha is my first friend. Barely got to know her. And this Aufra's her sister. If only I hadn't called her here. If I hadn't written to her, she might still be alive somewhere. Aufra's face crumples, and a solitary tear slides down her cheek. Oh my god. Option 3. Is there anything I can do? Aufra looks at you with some surprise, before dabbing at her nose with a sleeve. That's kind of you to offer, but I don't know if I could impose this on you. It's not a small favor. Aufra wipes her eyes. I'm worried about the baby, about the legacy. I told Kalisha as much as I could, but all I know is that for a long time now, every child born in Gilded Vale has been soulless, empty. It happened to so many mothers, and Lord Radric. He's exiled all of them, calling it a sign of the gods' disfavor. She sniffs. With my Hathort gone, I don't know how I'd manage if I lost my home, too. I hoped Kalisha could help me. They say Renga, the old midwife, knows a way to prevent a child being hollowborn. But she moved south to Anslog's Compass 2 seasons ago. The journey's too far for me. I can't make it as I am. But I don't have anyone else now with Kalisha gone. More tears run down her face. Please, can you help me? I'll find Ranga for you. Ooh. I'm going to read that in a sec. Aufra blinks, eyes wide. You will? Oh, gods bless you. Here, I'll give you coin to pay her with. You needn't trouble yourself with that. I think it's a drink she fashions out of... Well, I'm not sure, but it shouldn't be too much of a burden to carry back. You have earned a reputation. Reputations can be held with communities or factions in the Eastern Reach and will affect how members of that group respond to you. In some cases, friends or enemies of those groups will react to your affiliations. Helping a group will increase your positive reputation with that group. Harming a group will increase your negative reputation, of course. It is possible to have a mix of positive and negative reputation with a group if you help and harm them in equal measure. Anslog's Compass is what we call the lagoon to the south. You'll have to cross the wilds to get there. That's what keeps me from trying it myself. She clasps her hands together. Thank you again, truly. You'll be saving us both. She sets a hand on her stomach, smiling through her tears. Okay. Anything else to say?
Welcome.
I can't tell her she has a nice cat now. I hope Ranga agrees to help. I honestly don't know what else I can do. Any chance you could tell me a few things about Gilded Vale? I could certainly try. What would you like to know? Tell me about the village. Let me think. We're farmers mostly, but there's always been work and opportunity for people coming in from elsewhere. In the old days, at least. The Black Hammer Smithery's been here for a long time. That's Tuatanu's place, south of the mill. And then there's the Black Hound, just a ways south of here. She sighs, trailing off. I have to admit I don't go out much anymore, with that horrible tree out there. Things aren't like they used to be, but I don't have anywhere else to go. Whose lands are these? The Radrick family has held title over these lands for generations. Their keep is northeast of here, past the Estern Wood. She holds up a hand. I wouldn't go near him, mind. He doesn't see visitors or petitioners, not these days. Some people say that, well, that there are some bad seeds in that line. A weaker soul. Maybe that's why. She hesitates. Well, never mind. I'm sure Lord Radrick has his reasons. This worn, dog-eared book is titled Travels Upon the Seldglass Sea. There's an etched illustration of a vast finned leviathan. I'm gonna leave her her grain. Oh, rice. A good-sized sack of rice brought to the Deerwood by foreign traders. Milk, sugar. Plus one move speed for 20 seconds. Makes you move faster. A tin of fine powdery sugar used for sweetening dishes or providing a jolt of energy in a pinch. Interesting. I'll leave that stuff. I mean, if there was anything really valuable, I'd probably take it. I want to pet the cat. Food items cannot be used in combat, but can provide bonuses over a long period of time. Oh. So we take it and then enter combat. Zlox, the Usurper, and Clink. Oh, here's another voice from the past. You see a lone man standing in a field. He looks around, surveying the crops. Occasionally, he bends to examine a leaf up close. He is intent on what he is doing, completely absorbed in his work. This man approaches him from behind. He moves slowly, but does nothing to mask his approach. In his hand, he holds a large sword. There appears to be no malice or hatred in the man's demeanor. He almost seems pleased. The first man hears his approach and stands, turning away from the plant he was inspecting. His face breaks into a smile, and he opens his arms to welcome the approaching man. The smile freezes into a grimace as the second man thrusts the sword through his stomach, its blade now protruding from his back. His arms slowly fall to his side, and blood starts to drip from the sword onto the plants below the men. That was nice. As the first man crumples to his knees, the second pulls the sword out, a tear slowly falling down the cheek of his still smiling face. He's smiling and crying and killing somebody. So we can't ever talk to these named people. What about Clink? You see a small group of people gathered around the ruins of a house. The destruction continues out from the single dwelling through the entire village. Not a single building still stands. Rubble is scattered everywhere. One of the men in the group leans over something in the debris. It is this man, younger, barely more than a boy. The man reaches out and shakes the boy by the shoulder. The boy makes no sound and doesn't respond to the man's disturbance. The man looks up at the other members of the group and shrugs, standing to rejoin his friends. The boy suddenly sits up, eyes wide. He scrabbles backward away from the group, looking around in horror. The group moves toward him in unison, eliciting a yelp from the boy, who tries to move farther away. Drink. She turns to them reproachfully, motions for them to stay, then looks at the boy on the ground, who is trying to push himself through what remains of a wall. Oh, I think I skipped that. A woman in the group puts out her hand, stopping the rest. He seems unaware he has even stopped. The woman slowly moves toward the boy, hands out, speaking in a low, calming tone. For a time, the boy doesn't even hear. He just closes his eyes and braces himself against the wall, expecting violence. Eventually, the woman's words work through the fear, and he hears her. He opens his tear-filled eyes and stares at her. She holds out a hand to him. He looks at it, seeming confused by the offer, then hesitantly reaches out. She takes his hand in hers and leans down to help him stand. It's interesting. I keep wondering. Is this because of this disease or whatever we have? Does ale taste funny to you? I bet they have a better gold rot chew. You think she'll say yes? No. The city's where kith go for svef, not gold rot. Deerford, then? And then I told her that's not the pistol. Let's go sell this stuff. And then we'll go continue exploring.
Gods keep you.
Hold on to the sword for now. I'll keep one leather. You never know if we're gonna run into somebody who might need to be outfitted, so to join our group. I wanna hold on to this cloak. It's pretty interesting. I'm wondering who the Obsidian Order is. Oh, wait. Cool. Weapons and shields grant bonuses that stack with bonuses from other item types. Hi. The crops are blighted. The legacy is upon us. This place is cursed. There's only going to be more stories here. Yeah. Despite the rains, the stalks feel as dry and stiff as a locust's husk. Pilgrim's Crown. I think we have that before. I think we've gotten that before. Yeah. We found the first Pilgrim's Crown in the Veilwood. Let's see about Ronin Taronian. You see a group of people standing around a wagon, transfixed on a sword as it swings in a large, graceful arc. This man holds the sword, passing it from hand to hand with relaxed ease, making the blade dance in front of his audience. He tosses it into the air, spins, then puts his arm behind his back to catch it. The crowd claps excitedly, and a couple of them gasp, certain they are about to see a tragedy. Okay, that's the happiest pass I've seen so far, I think. Except for that guy who got the deer with the arrow when all the kids thought he wouldn't be able to. Hugo! You see a room, bright, warm, and covered in greenery. There isn't a spot in the entire space that doesn't have some kind of plant growing in it. Small germinating seeds in a corner here, large sprawling vines climbing the walls there. Although most of the plants are actually in some kind of container, there are a few that have grown from the dirt floor itself. These are just as lovingly cared for as anything else in the room. This man wanders through the plants, smiling at each and every one, an old pipe clenched between his teeth. Stopping next to one, he touches a leaf, lifting it up to look at the underside, then gently rubs it between his fingers. He takes a small handful of the soil it grows in and crushes it with his fingers. Satisfied, he drops the soil back into the pot and continues to the next plant. He hums a low, cheery tune as he moves among the plants, occasionally stopping to sing a few words of something to one of them. Finally, he reaches the door, having visited every plant in the room. He turns back to look at them, a look of serene pleasure on his face. Then he turns back and is gone. More bandits. Cows. New cows. Move for me. Damn you, move for me. Barret spell. Stalks are dry. Yeah, let's head this way. Thinking about joining family over in Deerwood. They have it far better than us. Some ale and beer. Alright, so we've been all along here. Why don't we check this out yet? That's the Temple of Eorthas? Oh yeah, we've been there. I didn't realize that was actually a temple. There's not much left of it. I want to walk right past the Black Hammer Smithery. Okay, so stay tuned next time when we go in Ingroad's house. Look at the windmill and the Black Hammer Smithery. And I don't know if there's much else to see in this land. Oh wow. No, let's just do that. Thanks for watching. See you next time. And a bang bang boogie, and don't stop the boogie.